So welcome back. This is now the last chapter of our lecture on diffraction. Now we are moving a little bit away from optical experiments. The chapter here, 2.46, is X-ray diffraction. However, X-ray is also nothing else than an electromagnetic wave. The only difference to optical spectroscopy is that the wavelength range of X-ray is in the order of 1 angstrom, so lambda is roughly 1 angstrom. That depends also on your X-ray source, but that's the order of magnitude. And 1 angstrom is 10 to the power of minus 10 meters. And that's now comparable to atomic distances. So X-ray diffraction goes back to quite a large number of interesting scientists. The most famous name is, of course, Wilhelm Röntgen. He was working in Würzburg and Munich in Germany, 1845 was his birthday, and he died in 1923. And he was awarded with the first Nobel Prize in physics in 1901. However, his experiments were not falling from the sky. A highly remarkable scientist, J.J. Thomson, was working already for years on a glowing cathode, and we'll come back to the glowing cathode in the next chapter, quantum mechanics. So he was working on vacuum tubes and glowing cathode, and then plate-like capacitor where he accelerated the electrons, and depending on the gas, highly diluted gas, of course, inside that glowing cathode, he could observe nice glowing effects. That sounds like a little bit of toy science. No, it was not at all. J.J. Thomson discovered the electron in 1897, and he was awarded with the Nobel Prize in 1906. Another remarkable detail about Thomson is the list of his PhD students. And I just wrote down a few of these names: Rutherford, Robert Oppenheimer, Bragg, William Bragg, Paul Lajoie, Niels Bohr, and many others. So the school of J.J. Thomson was outstanding, remarkable. So he was working with this glowing cathode and the effects of an electron. He first discovered the electron. And he was not the only one in the world. Other people were also working with these glowing cathode experiments. And one of them was Wilhelm Röntgen. In his laboratory, he discovered that photographic plates, which he had in a cupboard, closed and sealed off from any light, were completely illuminated. They were pitch black. And he was wondering whether that was an accident or if there's a certain reason for that. He investigated it in depth, and he discovered that such a glowing cathode can also produce another type of radiation, unknown radiation. And even in our days, if there's something unknown, we call it X-ray for unknown. So that name prevailed till our days. That's coming from the first days of X-ray tubes, X-ray for unknown radiation. The picture, the famous photograph of a hand with a ring, the first X-ray picture ever, that's also interesting. When he published it, within 48 hours, it was published on the title page of almost every newspaper in the world: London, Berlin, New York. It was so outstanding, people immediately recognized the potential behind that discovery. So, what is actually his experiment looking like? We have a vacuum tube, which actually looks like a large-sized light bulb, let's say that size. We have a glowing cathode here. So this is quartz glass, vacuum, a glowing cathode. The wire is so hot that it emits electrons. We have an accelerating voltage here, plate capacitor-like assembly. Excuse me. This accelerates the electrons in forward direction. And we have a stopping anode here. Let's say copper. The electrons are typically accelerated with a kinetic energy of 50,000 volt. That's the typical number used in hospital or here in-house for X-ray diffraction. The electrons hit the surface and are decelerated in a very short moment. In that moment, they release X-ray radiation in such a geometry in forward direction. This is how X-ray is produced. So the intensity spectrum of such an X-ray tube is looking like the follows. We have a high energy cutoff. And this is our 50,000 volt. However, each electron is stopped in a slightly different way, so we get a distribution function towards lower energies. And that looks like that. Doesn't necessarily be the zero here. This is the spectrum directly from the decelerated electrons. Deceleration, the German word for that is Bremsstrahlung. It's a German word. Why is that? Back 120 years ago, the scientific language worldwide was German, and after the Second World War, that has certainly changed to English. That's the spectrum from the deceleration of electrons, the Bremsstrahlung. On top, we might have sharp lines here in addition, and these are atomic transitions from the cathode material, the copper K alpha and the copper K beta lines. We will come to that chapter, atomic transitions, in one of the next lectures. And their energies are actually, let me put it here, 1.54 angstrom and 2.36. angstrom. As you remember from the previous chapters, energy is related to wavelength. So that's the spectrum which we get out of such an X-ray tube. So, 1901, this was discovered by Wilhelm Röntgen. At that time, he did not know the origin of this radiation. Keyword is X-ray for unknown ray. It was Max von Laue in 1914, Nobel Prize 1914, Max von Laue, German scientist again, Frankfurt and Berlin, and he did shine X-ray light on crystals. And he discovered sharp concentric rings. Same as we had discussed in the previous chapter, single slit experiment or single pinhole where we had these nice concentric rings. So, what does that mean? The explanation came 1 year later by Bragg, Bragg's law, Nobel Prize 1905, and they explained it that this is directly the diffraction of electromagnetic waves. And both together, the Max von Laue experimental evidence and the theoretical proof of Bragg's law, both together confirm two fundamental important things. First of all, X-ray is nothing else than a wave, electromagnetic wave. And second, atoms exist. You might be surprised about that statement, but if we go back 100 years ago, there was still a large number of scientists, more than half actually, who did not believe in the existence of atoms. They did believe that everything can be explained with mechanics and engineering, and it were people like Thomson, like Röntgen, Max von Laue, and Bragg, who actually opened up a total new field, quantum mechanics, chapter of our next lecture. One side note before I derive the Bragg's law for you. Bragg, these were actually two persons, father and son, William Bragg and Lawrence Bragg. That's, from my point of view, also remarkable. And another important one, while Lawrence Bragg was a British scientist, William Bragg was born in Adelaide. So you could actually say Bragg's law, that's the first Australian Nobel Prize. And I think that should be mentioned here as well. That's something to be proud of here in this country. So now, Bragg's law. I already started with that sketch here. If you have a crystal lattice, and perhaps you are aware of the beautiful crystal structure of natural quartz crystals or a diamond, or even in your kitchen, if you take a rock salt and a magnification lens, then you see the nice facets and the nice cubic shape of these crystals. Mother Nature loves symmetry. And what you are seeing here is a perfect geometrical arrangement of the atoms. And it's indeed true, the atoms, for example, in rock salt, form a perfect cubic crystal lattice. Not only these few atoms here on the board, but indeed billions of billions in each direction. So we have, in other words, a three-dimensional grating. If you treat each atom as a point source. We shine X-ray light now on these atoms. The important ingredient is the wavelength is roughly in the same order of magnitude as the atomic distances. Huygens principle, we can treat now each atom after it's being illuminated as a new point source. Behind that, the outgoing beam has to fulfill the same criterion as, again, of constructive superposition. So in order that the wavefronts here and here match each other, the path difference must be n times lambda. That's the condition for constructive superposition, as always. So what's our path difference now here? So we have an incoming beam, an outgoing beam, and a scattering angle of theta here. Of course, by geometry, both must be identical. The path difference, so that beam here is directly reflected, and that beam gets reflected at that atomic plane. The path difference now is this section here and this section here. Let's call that S. So the total path difference is 2 times S. What is S? The distance from here to here is D. Here, our scattering angle theta shows up again. So sinus theta is here, if you look at that triangle, S divided by D. Now we can merge both together and we get Bragg's law. Two D sinus theta is N lambda. And this rule can be used now in crystallography to determine the distance between individual atomic planes, so directly the atomic distances. On top, it provides us far more information about the symmetry of a crystal, the internal arrangement of atoms. I'll have a PowerPoint presentation where I can show you some of our actual results on real scientific research. That's the Bragg's law. It allows you to determine directly the atomic distances to be precise, the distance between atomic planes and lambda, the wavelength of the incoming beam. More about that in the PowerPoint presentation. Thanks a lot.